Exeter. We're at Rediscover Church, and we're so happy that you've joined us this morning.
Yes, good morning.
Yeah, so I'm Ella.
And I'm Elliot.
Elliot, how has your week been? How are you doing?
Oh, it's been really good.
Glad to hear it.
Really good, yeah. I was in Plymouth on Friday, and I watched Mamma Mia.
Love that film. Was it the play?
It was the show.
Nice,
yeah.
Amazing.
It was fantastic.
Brilliant.
Absolutely loved it.
I hope wherever you are, you've had a great week and you're excited because it's Sunday and it's a special Sunday here at church.
It is indeed. It is. It is a completely student-led service today, Ella.
Every team today is made up of students, so that's worship. We've got student speakers, the welcome team, and of course us.
Yeah.
So we're really excited that you've joined us this morning. We've got some exciting things coming up and we hope you really enjoy it.
Yes. Please do get involved on the online chat at the right of your screen. And just pop a message to our online pastors who will be more than happy.
We'd love to pray
chat with you. Yeah.
And we'll be following along as well. So if you have anything that you want us to talk about or address, or if you have any questions, we'd love to hear from you and get to know you.
Definitely, yeah.
Cool. So, first up, we have some worship. Worship is a time where we just connect with God. We thank Him for everything that He's doing in our lives. So, just wherever you are, I just pray that you can plug into that and enjoy that experience.
Definitely.
And yeah, just have a great morning wherever you are. Cool. Yes. Enjoy.
Enjoy.
Just clap our hands.
Set my feet on solid ground. Yours now forever. And nothing's gonna hold me back. Nothing's gonna hold me back. Nothing's gonna hold me back. My chains fell off, my heart was free. I'm alive.
because of what you've done, God.
Yes.
We thank you so much for who you are, Jesus. Thank you, God.
You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High, hidden glory. Your hidden glory in creation, now revealed.
forever reign over all, God. We thank you for your presence in this place. We thank you that you've brought everyone here for a reason. I thank you that you know exactly what's going on in every single one of these persons' hearts. Father, I just thank you that you stop for the one, that you look at us not as a mass of people or as an institution, but as your children, that you look at us and see our individual hearts, that you know everything about us. You formed us in the womb, that you know everything about us, God, and you love everything about us. Oh, you're so good, Lord. While I was just standing there, this image of my church back home in Sussex, we don't have a lot of decorations, but we do have this one massive cross in the middle right there, and it's made up of loads of separate pictures of pieces of art that people did prophetically. They were painting as worship, and each individual picture shows a different image of worship or of God. There's trees, there's people, there's rivers, there's so many different pictures, but they all join together to form one cross. And I just really felt like that was a message for us today, that there is no one on this earth who has the same relationship with God as you do. And my relationship with God is completely unique to myself. And your relationship with God is completely unique to you. Your walk with him is unique, just as you are. And just like those pictures in the cross, by themselves, they can seem a little chaotic or out of place. And maybe that's how you're feeling this morning. Maybe you've come into this place, maybe even for the first time, and you're feeling out of place. You feel like you're not really making sense. But I feel like God is just calling me to say that you fit in here, you're welcome here, and together we are all facing that cross. We're all joined together to form the perfect image of Jesus. And I just think that's such a challenge for the church today, that we're all individuals and we're all broken, and we've all got our own baggage, but when we face Jesus, we join together and form that cross. We form that orderly picture of heaven on earth, of glory on earth. And yeah, I really feel like that's a prayer for some of us today, that if you're feeling out of it, if you feel like this is completely unnatural being here, or if you feel like nobody knows what you're going through, nobody knows your situation, you just feel completely isolated, I want to pray for you today, that you will feel accepted and welcome in the family of Christ, that he has died to bring you in. He sacrificed himself so that you can feel welcome here. You are so welcome. You're so welcome in the family of God. And I just want to spend some time with our church family joining together to pray for each other. So if you're feeling hurt or broken this morning, if you're feeling like there's healing that you want God to act on it, or if you're going through a really dry place, we just want to spend some time praying for you, and we'll have some people gather around you, people who know and love God. And so if you're feeling like that this morning, if you're feeling like you want some prayer from your brothers and sisters here, could you just raise your hand? And everyone else, if you can just look around the room, see who's got their hands raised, and just gather around them. If you know and love Jesus, just gather around your brothers and sisters now. You don't have to ask what the situation is. You don't have to ask what's going on, but just be there for them. Just ask the Spirit of God to intervene, because he will. I pray, Lord, I pray that your Spirit would move in this place. I pray that we'd see hearts changed. Jesus, come and move in this place. Come and move in these precious people and your precious children. Thank you, God.
Father, just come in this place and pour out your spirit onto your children. Pour out your spirit of love and of peace and of joy. Let them know your goodness, Father. Let them know what it feels like to be loved by a totally pure love, a pure love that transcends all understanding. We can never understand it, and I praise you for that, Jesus. Father, come and fill this place. Come and move hearts, Lord. Your spirit can move mountains. I pray that you'd move the mountains in people's lives. You can move hearts, Lord Jesus. You can move hearts. And be working through the people. Now as we just sing another song of worship, I pray that your eyes would just be focused on that cross, focused on the sacrifice that Jesus made for you, because he came for you. If you were the only person on earth, he would still die. He would still die for you. Let's just rejoice in that fact. Let's just rejoice in the goodness of our Father. It's so good, Jesus.
The Spirit of the Lord is here. Your presence. We can come as we are. We are broken and messed up, but you love us just the same. Lord, I thank you that you welcome us with open arms, that you run towards us and embrace us. I just thank you for that, Jesus. Come and move in this place, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Good morning, everybody. So good to see you all here. So if you came in a bit late, we are holding a student service this morning, which is very exciting. Very exciting. We had a great 9:30 service. God was really moving in that place. It was amazing. It was so good. It's so good to welcome you guys here this morning. Cool. So, first job. We need to say hello to our online audience because we've got people streaming in from all over the country, perhaps even wider than the country. We've got people tuning in to experience what's happening here, and we want to give them a nice big welcome. So, if we can turn to that camera, this camera here, give them a nice big wave and cheer. Cool, nice. So we also have another welcome to give, which is for people who haven't been in this church before. If it's your first time visiting us today, we want to do two things, welcome you in two ways, and that is to give you a big cheer, and we also want to give you a box of chocolates. I also thought I might say, my first experience of Rediscover Church, I got given a box of After Eights, which I was not... No! But I think they're Maltesers today, so you're in luck. So if it is your first time today, can you just give us a big wave and we'll give you a big cheer?
Hello again.
Hello, welcome back.
Yeah, we're back in the studio. Hope you're having a great morning so far. Mm. Worship was amazing.
Oh, it was great, wasn't it?
So good.
I love it.
Love it.
I love it.
Such a good way to kick off your Sunday morning, but worship.
It definitely is.
So we've got so much else coming up. We've got some student speakers. But first, we're just going to have a little bit of a chat.
Yes, we are. So.
Natural.
Yeah. Ella, you are a student here at Exeter.
I am a student. I'm second year.
Fantastic. What are you studying?
I'm doing English and drama combined.
Ooh. How are you finding that?
Pretty good.
Yeah.
I don't know, I changed my mind over which bit of the course I like best, but I think at the moment English might be just about winning.
Okay.
But drama's pretty good too, so.
Good stuff, good stuff. And do you enjoy Exeter?
I love Exeter. So I don't think before I came to uni here, I'd never been. I don't think I've ever actually been to Exeter before I turned up on my first day for freshers. But I love it now, it's definitely my home. I feel very settled.
Brilliant, brilliant.
Yeah.
So, yeah, where are you from?
I am originally, I'm a bit all over the place, kind of Ireland, England, Surrey, now Gloucestershire.
Exotic.
A bit all over the place.
That's fantastic. Yeah, so how do you find being a student at university, but also being a Christian?
I mean, I'd say, to summarise, I'd say an opportunity. Like, it's okay. It's not always easy in that, like, you feel like a bit of a responsibility. You know, we are carrying the name of Christ in our identity. But it's so definitely fun, especially like on, I don't know about other unis, but our campus is just so much going on in terms of Christian gatherings. So we've got CU, we've got NUMA, so much fun things to be a part of. And it's so cool because it's always something that you can be a part of, something you can find your fit. So personally, I do some stuff for CU, which is really fun.
Oh, nice. That. Yeah. How do you find that? Is that cool?
Really good. So we actually had our CU events week. Maybe last week it's gone, wow. It's gone really fast. So we had things going on every lunchtime and every evening. We had these things called lunch bars.
Okay, yeah, explain. So I'm intrigued.
So free food and a talk. It's very exciting every day for a week.
Come on.
And they were so good, and it was such a good opportunity to invite people who maybe would otherwise come and hear the gospel. Such a good opportunity.
So that's primarily for non-Christians, just a way of
kind of very chill, like, you know, obviously the whole point is that we want them to encounter the gospel, but the talks themselves are so interesting and very varied. Really cool.
So yeah, Jesus and a sandwich.
Jesus and a sandwich. There you go.
What a combination that is. That's great.
So, yeah.
Yeah, thank you for that.
No worries, my
That's
friend.
That's great.
Cool. So what's coming up next?
That's a great question. What is coming up next?
So.
I do know.
Go on next.
We're going to cut over to the service, and there's going to be some interviews, some talks, some testimonies, and then we'll go into about a 25-minute message with Femi, who will be bringing the word, so that would be great.
But make sure that you stick around, because we'll be back at the end of the service.
Definitely.
We're going to be interviewing some amazing students about all they're doing. So
yes.
Stick around and see you in a bit. Enjoy the rest of the service.
Bit.
Good morning, Rediscover. Hello. All right, we'll bring the meet and greet to a close. Hi. Okay, for those of you who haven't met me before, I am Bronnie. I'm a first year drama student, and I'm all the way from Newcastle in the north, so it's quite a long drive to get down here. But I mean, I'm here now at uni. I didn't just come today, 12 hours south, it's fine. Okay, I've got some notices for you guys. So Thursday at 7:30 in the cafe downstairs, if you've been coming to Rediscover for a while and you feel quite rooted here, it's going to be a Discover membership night. So if you want to just find out a bit more about membership, then that is a good night for you. Thursday at 7:30 in the cafe downstairs. Second notice, Breathe is this Friday. Yes, Breathe at 7:30 in the auditorium. We have a church worship night every last Friday of the month, so yeah, don't miss it. It's going to be absolutely great. And the final announcement is there's a men's breakfast this Saturday at 8:30 till 10 a.m. And it's going to be a time of fellowship with the guys, and I assume there's going to be bacon butties, I think. So yeah, get yourselves along to that. Okay, so that's the notices. I think now it's time for some funky, jazzy interviews. All right, yes, okay, let's go.
Yeah, oh, it's the comfy chair. Yeah, oh, it's the comfy chair. Yeah, oh, comfortable.
That's sweet music. It's the first time I've heard that. That's great, right? Okay, so first here this morning, we have Anna and Daisy. Okay, right, we're going to kick off the interviews with Anna. Ooh, drum roll.
Hi.
So, What do we do for students here at Rediscover?
So there's actually a lot of students at Rediscover Church. They're everywhere. And we meet fortnightly on a Monday night on the balcony. And we worship and pray together. And sometimes Femi brings a message, or we share testimony. And we want to connect with the wider church. We don't want to just stick to our student bubble. And we've had members of the church come and give testimony. Mark and Nita have joined us. Once that was amazing, and also we have like student life groups for guys and girls that meet fortnightly as well.
Nice one.
Oh, and student lunches happen as well.
Oh, I like those ones.
Yeah, food.
Cool. And so, what have we been up to so far this academic year? And also, what are we going to do into the future of the rest of this academic year so far? Mm-hmm.
So the Monday nights are quite a recent thing. They started in October, and we just wanted, like, Femi talked to a few of us, and we were like, what do we want to do as students? Do we want to have, like, socials and invite friends and like, have movie nights or whatever? But really, we just wanted to be vulnerable with each other and connect with each other and share. And so... yeah, they started in October and they've just grown and been amazing. And yeah, it's such a great way to get to know people truly. And I really want to thank Femi for his leadership. Yeah, we're so blessed. We're so blessed to have Femi. And also, we've launched a like student-aged girls life group that meets fortnightly on a Saturday for brunch. And if you haven't been to any of the things I've mentioned before, you're so welcome. It's not an exclusive group, and people from other churches join us, people who have never been to church join us. So yeah, come along. And in the future, we again, like I said, we really want to connect with the wider church. And we thought if anyone is passionate about discipleship and would like to disciple a student, if you'd like to chat to Femi, that would be really cool, because yeah, he's in charge of it all.
Nice one. Yeah, praise God for that. That sounds great. Yeah, okay, moving on then to Daisy. I drew a flower next to her name, my homemade script. It's the drama student in me. So how did you personally come to know Jesus, and what's like your story? It's quite a general question, but yeah.
I think the best answer for that is slowly. My mum is a Christian. She's also incredible, the best human, love her. But she basically had a rule in our house that you went to church until you were 10, and that was when you were deemed old enough to decide. And if you, any of you have African parents, you know saying no is not, it's not a thing. You don't, you just, if you want to eat or sleep or remain in your home, saying no is not a thing. But so I went to church till I was 10, carried on going. But for me, it was always sort of an obligation that I went to, because I loved seeing my friends and I loved having fun with it. But it wasn't something I felt personally connected to until last year, I think, actually. And Anna invited me to come to church with her. And I was a bit intimidated because I haven't had the most positive experiences with churches. But the first time I was in here, I just burst into tears and was just crying, because I'd really felt like God was telling me to go home, not to go to a specific church or not to do like anything specific, but to actually come home. It was a really weird feeling. It's like that bit when you're the top of a roller coaster and you're going about to go down. I mean, I don't go on roller coasters because of the heights. No. But I've heard that it feels like that. And I felt really drawn to that. And the thing that I found really good about this church is, as Anna was saying, the vulnerability. That people are okay with saying that they're not all perfect, they don't have their sort of life together. And I think it kind of taught me that God meets you where you are. And it's not about God saying, wait, I'm gonna wait until you've got your life together, until you're perfect, until you're not messy. But God meets you where you are and says, I love you anyway. And I found that quite overwhelming. And my first conversation with Ife, actually, we were talking about it, and it sort of clicked to me for the first time that the whole point of salvation is nothing to do with us. It's not anything we earn or anything that we have to be a certain way to deserve, but God just goes, I love you, and that's that. And if I was saying to me that if you read the gospel and you get it, you're not reading it properly, because that gift of grace is just inexplicable. So I think that it took me a long time to make it a faith that was mine, not my mum's, which I think for a lot of people who grew up in Christian homes, that's a distinction you have to make and a journey you have to make. But I'm not all there. I don't think any of us are. But it's really exciting. It's a really, it's a bit of a weird thing because it's terrifying and not at the same time. Because we're, as Christians, called to love God and love other people, and everything else kind of falls into place. Yeah. So it's been a really interesting journey. But I mean, praise God, to be honest.
Yeah, definitely. Round of applause for that. Thank you. That's great. So final question for you. How has being in the church and your friendships affected you over the past year?
Like, so much. I mean, the people, the students, and like everyone that I've met in this church has been incredible, which is really nice for me to have such, it's been such a welcoming environment. And as I said, I found church is quite intimidating, but it's, everyone here has been so lovely. And it was Anna, the reason I came. And Anna's amazing. If you don't know Anna, you should, because she's incredible. And so yeah, Anna and Lottie were two of the people that I came with for the first time. And I've developed some really amazing friendships here. You, my number one, even though you make Badger off. It's true. But yeah, the people here have been incredible. And it's just, I think, as Anna was saying, fellowship for me is really important. And those Monday nights are so good, because it's a time that everyone comes together and there's no pretenses. No one is there because they feel like they need to be there for other people. We're all there for the same reason, to spend time with God. And something that I've been learning recently is God does not call the qualified, he qualifies the called. And that has been something that's, those Monday nights and the friendships that I've developed have really shown me that. Because I mean, Lazarus, an example, God was like, you're dead, but you're not done. Which I think is just, yeah. So those friendships have been amazing.
That's brilliant. You're done, but you're not done. Thank you, that's absolutely great. Thank you. Okay, well that concludes the first round of interviews and we'll be back for more later. So I'm going to invite the band back up now whilst we collect and give for God to do with the church for money and things like that. So yeah, here we go, collection time.
Hello. Oh, mine's working. If you'd all like to stand up, Rez, just going to sing a song while we take our offering. This is, if you feel that this church is your home and you'd like to contribute financially, then please do as the baskets go by. If not, it's okay. So we're going to do our offering song now.
To hide his face.
is righteousness alone. Faultless stand before the
carry on now, I think, with the next batch of interviews, if anyone's ready. Will there be any funky music this time?
Yeah, there it is.
Let's go dance it, Eva. Yes. Yes, as you can see, we have Iffa and Matt. Round of applause for them. I really want to learn that dance now. We should do that next time. Okay, I'm going to kick off the questions this time with Matt. So, I heard you're into fashion. And I heard you're into mission. And I heard you like to combine the two into, what does it say on t-shirt? Nissy. Do you want to give us a bit of information about that?
So yeah, hi, I'm Matt. And basically, I was saying earlier, I like fashion because I heard the other week, when you get up in the morning, everyone's a bit of a blank canvas. And it's, you decide to dress yourself in whatever art that you feel appropriate in the form of clothes. And I love fashion in that sense of an art form. So where that comes into mission, I started my own clothing brand in the summer. It's called Nissy, and I'll talk about the name of that in a second, but I really felt that God put it on my heart to start it, and the idea really popped into my head about a year ago now, and I felt like it was a bit of a turning point in my faith, and I'd been going through a few battles, and it appears the word Nissy appears in the Bible once in Exodus 17, and it's a story you might have heard about. The Israelites battling someone called the Amalekites, and when Moses lifts his arms up, the battle's winning in the Israelites' favor, but he's got to lift his arms up to God all day, holding the staff of God. And I just felt, and then so that, yeah, at the end of that story, he makes an altar to God and dedicates it with the name Jehovah Nissi, which is translated to "The Lord is our banner." In our modern translations, so that's why the little logo is a banner. I just felt it in my life that I'd been going through a few battles, and I really just felt God want me to dedicate that to Him. But so the brand itself, I want it to be fashion that anyone can wear, something that people can enjoy, not just for Christians, and something that I can express my love of God through. But something from that passage in Exodus 17, I'm just going to get up on my phone, that I wanted to share. It popped into my head earlier. And it's halfway through. So after the battle had won, God says to them, the Lord said to Moses, write this on a scroll as something to be remembered and make sure Joshua hears it, because I will completely blot out the memory of Amalek under heaven. So they're the people who they've just fought against, and they've just won, and God said, I'm going to completely blot them out from under heaven. And yet, you actually read in the Bible that the Amalekites and the Israelites still have feuds ongoing all the way up until like Esther. And even though God promised that he's going to blot them out, like there's still that trouble in their life. There's still that battle. And there's sometimes you might find that, oh, we've won the battle. There's still stuff that keeps popping up and you think, hang on, I've already won that. But God has made a promise that he's already delivered. He's going to blot that out from under the kingdom of heaven. So that's something I thought I'd mention. Anyway, so back to this. So I just, the way I see it, it's kind of an art form which I can express God's love through. And so everything I make aims to be fair trade. And 10% of the profits at the moment go to charity helping Syria crisis. And I want to develop that more and more, but obviously slow and steady wins the race. I'm only just starting out. But yeah, so check it out if you want. The website's nissy.bigcartel.com, and the Instagram and the Facebook is nissy.clothing. So I'm working on it a lot at the moment. I'm going to try and bring a few new things out next week. So it's all really exciting for me. But that's how I bring fashion into mission. Okay.
That's absolutely great. Thank you. So. I'm also informed you're a medical student. I was told by a little bird, Fermi, that you're a medical student. And because you love mission so much, how do you combine that with your degree also?
Yeah, so for me, I see myself as a tool. If someone calls you a tool, it's probably a bad word, isn't it? If I was a Fermi, you're such a tool. But no, I felt God putting it on my heart that I'm a tool, and I need to sharpen myself for whenever God needs me. If he's the worksman, then I should be his tool. And I'm in such a privileged place to be doing medicine, to be here in Exeter. I'm so lucky. And I think when I first joined, I just thought, it's a doctor, I'll get a good job sorted. But now I really want to practice my faith through that, so that might end up me being... I could end up in England and still do that, but there's so much opportunity for me to like go overseas and work as a doctor somewhere like that. So that's exciting. There's a lot of logistical stuff I need to sort out, and still a lot of training I need to do. But like Lottie was saying earlier, everyone's got their own journey, and it reminded me of the parable of the talents. If you don't know, go look it up, but I'm not gonna explain it. But basically, like, whatever God's given you, however small, however big, give it back to him. And that's what I feel.
Amen to that. Round of applause. Thank you, Matt. Thank you so much. Okay, moving the questions to Efa. How you doing? That's great. Let's carry on. So...
oh. Yes.
She's here.
We have power. Okay.
That's some idea of student ministry, but let's move on to what you do. You, I heard, are a president.
I am indeed. Better than Donald Trump.
Exactly.
I busted that joke out in first service, so it's not really new anymore.
It's so true, though. You're president of something called NUMA.
Yes.
Am I correct?
Yes! All my NUMA people!
Why don't you tell us a bit about that?
Yeah, NUMA is one of the Christian societies on campus. There are a couple of them, along with like ECU. I know that there's some ECU people here. NUMA is Greek for breath or spirit. And that's because as a society, we want to be spirit-led. We always say that every Wednesday is a chance to encounter the Holy Spirit. We meet on Wednesdays, and our centrals vary sometimes. We'll usually always have testimonies because we like to hear about what God's doing in everybody's lives. And then sometimes we'll have a talk or we'll have a Bible study, and it's just really good finding that fellowship. We just feel that students need to have that fire for God on campus and have that outlet to be able to spread that, a place where you can invite your friends, a place where you can be around like-minded people. Like this phrase my mum always used to say, she used to say to me, iron sharpens iron. And you hear that like your whole life. And I'll admit, it never really kind of clicked until I came to uni and I started going to NUMA, because you don't even realize how much the people that you hang out with influence your actions subconsciously. And just hanging out with Christians, because when I first started in first year, majority of my friends weren't Christians. And then halfway through first year, started going to NUMA properly and just noticing the changes in my attitude, in my outlook. And we just want to sharpen each other, be that positive student presence on campus, and spread the fire for God.
Nice one. Yeah, another round of applause. Yes. So final question to conclude. What's being the president, you must see like a lot going on in your like society. So what's your favorite kind of thing about being president?
My favorite thing about being president?
Yeah.
The power.
The truth comes out now.
I'd say my favorite thing about being president is actually watching people grow. Just seeing how people came in September to where they are now and the changes that God does in people's lives. Last week, I don't know if you did notice, but NUMA went on a weekend away, so we all went to St. Ives in Cornwall, and it was absolutely incredible, just the breakthroughs that happened and seeing how God has just worked in people's lives. Like, people said that they felt released, they felt chains being broken. We had people that had stage fright just coming up to the front and being confident and bold enough to share what God was doing for them. And just, like, I mean, for someone like me, I don't really get stage fright. It's not a big deal. But, like, for other people, you know, it's amazing just seeing the growth and development of people. And that's the bit I enjoy the most, I'll say.
That's great. Praise the Lord for what's going on here with student ministry. Amen. Okay, now moving on to the next part of the service. It's the part we've all been waiting for. Yeah. Drum roll. It is, it's the chat from Femi.
Femi.
No, here we go.
Hey, everyone. Having the students been awesome. This is not the part you've been waiting for. The part you've been waiting for has happened. The students leading the worship, students putting together the welcome team and the refreshments. Haven't they done an awesome job? Come on. Come on. Students, we just salute you. You've been fantastic. And, you know, to be in a service where you can feel the presence of God being led by this generation is fantastic, so thank you so much. I'm going to dip into the word today, and I'm going to open up Psalm chapter 1 from verse 1 to 3, and it will appear on the screens. And it says, "Blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of the mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his word, on his law, day and night. That person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do, prospers." And this is the scripture we're going to focus on today. I just want to be real today, and I feel that the word and the message that I'm going to share today is really poignant and relevant for the season that we're in as a church. We're in a season of adventure. For those of you who don't know, in a month's time exactly, on March the 19th, we booked out the Great Hall for a Sunday service. And that is absolutely exciting. We can't wait. But I feel that as we go into that season, there is a call on this church to be rooted in the word of God. There is a call on us to be so engulfed and so mesmerized by this book, to be so in love with the words of our risen King, Jesus Christ, and to nourish on it and to feed on it as it feeds our soul. And so I'm going to unpack that today because I feel that's important. Student ministry is awesome. We've seen today that students have connected with God, and they may not necessarily have it all worked out, but they know that they have found a treasure in Jesus Christ that they consider worth living for and worth exploring, and that is awesome. One of the most remarkable things for a student to do is during their 3 years at university connect with the gospel, the good news of Jesus, the fact that God so loves us, and this frees us. This frees us, and it frees students to live a life where they can see chains broken, see this world transformed. We get told in the Bible that this world is broken, and God wants us to be his hands and feet to rescue the lost, to save people who are in captivity. And so it's a joy to see students step into this promise. But can I share a burden and a pain that's been on my heart recently? As I said, I want to be real. I've seen students dive into the depths of God. We heard earlier, you know, Anna sharing all those beautiful things about what we do here as a church to support student ministry. I promise you, I didn't pay her to say all those nice things about me, as lovely as that was. Thank you, Anna. We heard Daisy share about how she uncovered the mystery of Jesus and the gospel over the last year, how she really encountered God's love and the scandalous grace that he gives to us. We heard Matt talk about how he's driven to do mission with his clothing brand Nissi. We heard Ifa about what God is doing on campus. And this is awesome. And on one side, it feels like we have students who are so saturated in the love of God, saturated in his presence, drenched. They've dived deep into his love and they are drenched. But on the other, it feels like there are students who have chosen to stay high and dry. There are students who I've even heard over the last year say, I'm not a Christian anymore. Yeah. And we read in the Bible that when Peter went to deny Jesus three times, just before he did, Jesus says, the enemy, Satan, has come to sift you like wheat, but I have prayed for you so that your faith may not fail. And it feels like the enemy has come to sift students like wheat, and he's come to give them the sucker punch of life. And some students have been utterly defenseless to this. They've been defenseless to the trials and the temptations that life can bring. And it's got me asking why. Why? How can a student just be so in love and seem to have a faith 1 year and the next just seems to have fizzled out? And we do the diagnostics. We look at their walk and what they're doing, and we dig below the surface and we see that there weren't any roots. And if there were, the roots weren't deep enough. And in church, I believe that God is calling us to be so rooted in his word and his life, to be so captivated by what he wants to communicate to us through his written word. Let's take a look through scripture. It's going to appear on the screen, but in John 10:10, Jesus says, the thief comes to only to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. In John 6:35, Jesus says again, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me, and let's let this sink in, whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. In Matthew 6:11, Jesus says again, give us this day our daily bread. And that's what we now know as the Lord's Prayer. Give us today our daily bread. There is something so special about the word. And I just feel privileged to unpack just three things. There are beautiful things about the word, but I'm just going to share three things with you today that I feel God wants us to get. So the first is that the word is our window. The word is our window to know who God is. One of the most important questions we can ask in life is that if there is a God, who is he? If there is a God, what is he like? And so the Christian God and the beauty of the God we know and believe in this church and across the city and across the world is that the Christian God has made himself known to us through his word. Exactly how he feels about us is known to us through his word. We read in Genesis how we were once one with God. We were so intimate. We were in the Garden of Eden, and we could talk to God, and God could talk back to us, and it was all beautiful bliss, intimacy, perfection. And then because of our mistakes, because of what we did wrong, our sin, we had to separate, because what's holy cannot be with what's unholy by default. It's got to separate. But then we see that our God didn't leave us this way. He wanted to do something about it. We heard Daisy share that God loves us so scandalously that he can't see us separated from him. And so let's look at his word to see how he feels about us. Let's turn to Romans chapter 5 from verse 7 to 8, and it'll appear on the screen as well. And this is what it says about God, exactly how he feels about us. It says, "Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." And so the Bible is saying that if me and you, if we were going to take a bullet for someone, okay, I cannot think of that many people who I'll take a bullet for. Just going to be honest. I do love you, but take a bullet, that's one thing. The Bible says, if I was going to take a bullet for someone, I would choose maybe the nicest person I know, like the bestest of my friends. And Jesus says that he didn't wait for us to be good and perfect to take the bullet for us. He said, while we were still against him, while we were still in our sin, doing life our own way, he would come across the bridge and bridge the gap by his love. And he died on the cross, and we see that when he died on the cross, that was the moment of reconciliation where he said, I'm going to make things right with you. And to even make it better, let's turn to Colossians chapter 2, verse 13 to 14. It's going to appear on the screens as well. And it says, when you were dead in your sins, in this uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having cancelled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. And this is the beautiful part. This is the beautiful part. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. There was a gap between us and God. And God says, I've seen that gap. I've seen, and other religions don't do this. Other religions have stopped it. Other religions say you have to earn your way to God. You know, pray X amount of times a day. You have to do good. You have to be a good person. God says, no, I've seen the gap. I've seen your deficiency, and I'm going to bridge it. And so he says that I see that gap, and I nailed it to the cross. And this is the beauty of our God, that the way he feels about us, his disposition towards us, is known through his word. And so the word, first of all, is a window to us knowing who God is, his love for us, His intense burning desire to know us. So I just want to encourage you in this room, there is no barrier between you and God. There is no barrier between you and God. If you were in the service earlier and you were praying and you were feeling, oh, I just can't get through, there is no barrier because Jesus has taken away that barrier. Great. So that's the first one. The word is our window. The second one is that the word is our anchor. So we're looking at the things that are special about the word of God. We've gone through the word is our window, and now the word is our anchor. And this is important. Who knows that for every season in your life, God wants to give you a scripture or a word to encourage you, to root you, to guard you, to protect you, to challenge you, to inspire you. He wants to give you a word. And we see it time and time again in the Bible when, for example, Moses was taken out of Egypt. Didn't have a clue what he was going to do after that, but all he knew is that he had to leave Egypt. He had to run away, taken into the wilderness. And what happened? God sends his word and speaks to Moses in a burning bush. We see again Joshua, the man who was going to replace Moses and actually take the Israelites into the promised land, because this was God's plan. We see that when he takes on the mantle of Moses, God says, do not be afraid. We see the prophet Jeremiah, when Jeremiah had a call in his life to be a prophet to the nations. And he was so young, and he was saying, God, I don't know what to say. I'm only young. Some of us here who are young, students, youth, you might feel that, I don't know what to say. How could I encourage an adult? How could I minister the gospel? I'm only 16, 17, 18. And the perfect words of God, this is what he says. He says, don't worry. Don't look at your age. I will put the words in your mouth. A bit like what Daisy said earlier about God doesn't call the equipped. He equipped the called. So the word. God can give you an encouraging word. And if we just turn back to Psalm chapter 1, verse 3, just take a look at it. It says, blessed is the one, it says. the person is like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields fruit in season. And that's what it says. So the beautiful thing about staying connected with God is that we don't just bear fruit anyhow, but we bear it in season. And I want us to take note, if we just get verse 3 back up on the screen, I want us to take note of when it says streams. Streams. Blessed is the one who meditates on the law of God day and night. He will be like a person planted by streams of water. Note how it didn't say pond or lake. It said streams. A pond or a lake has stagnant water. It's not moving. But God wants us to be by streams. And this is important because in life, as we're trying to bear fruit, as we're trying to grow, as we're trying to live up to what God has put in us, God has put His Spirit inside us and wants to change this broken world, as we're trying to bear fruit, pollutants will try and enter our river and corrupt our tree, corrupt us from the inside out. Pollutants will try and get into our water system, and there's a pollutant called fear, there's a pollutant called anxiety, there's a pollutant called anger, there's a pollutant called distrust of people. And all these pollutants just try and enter our stream, enter our water supply, and try and corrupt our tree from the inside out. And the beautiful thing about the Bible saying streams is that if any of these pollutants try and enter your water supply, they're washed away by the stream. It's not a pond, it's not a lake. It's a moving supply of water. It's a moving supply of scripture. And I want to encourage you, I was praying over today, and I feel God is doing a lot, but I specifically felt that in both services, God wanted people who were looking for this deep, unsearchable peace to know the peace of God in their situation and in their lives. And being rooted in the scriptures, being rooted in the word of God would help us that when we feel anxious, when we feel worried, we call to mind the stream of scriptures, and we think of scriptures like Philippians 4, 6 to 7, and it will come up on the screen. Philippians 4, 6 to 7, and it says, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God." And this is the beautiful part. It's like gearing up to it. "And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and mind in Christ Jesus." And I believe that every time that pollutants try and get into our water supply, we've got to call to mind this stream of scriptures. I want to ask some people, is your stream looking a bit stagnant? Does it look like a bit more of a pond than a flowing stream? Do you need to refresh yourself in the word of God? So number two, anchor. So the special thing about the word of God is that number one, it's our window to know who God is, his love for us. Number two, it's our anchor. Number three, it's our nourishment. It's our nourishment. If we are apart from the scriptures and the word of God, the Bible, we become malnourished. But if we're connected, if we get verse three back up on the screen, it says, the person will yield its fruit in season. Not just yield fruit. It's good to yield fruit as a Christian. But what is it like to have the fruit in season? In season. And that is very interesting for us today. Because if we all just imagine, just for 1 second, what would it look like if when it was harvest time around the world, farmers were, in each and every country, farmers were going to their farms and their fields, and workers were arriving, turning up, expecting and hoping to yield this huge crop of vegetables and this huge crop of fruit. And the farmers went to the tree, went to pluck off the apple, but there was just nothing there. What would that be like? I mean, the world would go crazy, right? I mean, the world would go absolutely crazy. The food chain would just break down, and I shudder to think of our vegans and vegetarians in the building. You know, some of you would die. I mean, come on. And you know, I said some because the others would repent and start to eat meat again, but they would see the light. Joking. Joking. You like to banter. But how many of us know that scripture isn't just for ourselves, but it's to feed those around us as well. When our lives bear fruit, it affects those around us, the lives around us as well. But I want to share, I want to be vulnerable, I want to share about a time when I was pretty malnourished. And funnily enough, I've just said that it's good to bear fruit because the fruit affects other people, and that's good. But there was a time in my life, in my final year of university in November, when I was helping to lead NUMA, which is the Christian society that Ife spoke about earlier, and I was just so malnourished. And the reason why was that I was reading scripture, but I was only reading it to encourage someone else. I was reading scripture, but I was only reading it to take to a Bible study and to lead that, or to go and speak to someone on a coffee and encourage them. And I realized that I was reading scripture for other people, but not to nourish myself, not to nourish my own spirit. And just get really vulnerable. That, during that period of time, I didn't preach in NUMA. I chose not to because I knew that I wasn't overflowing with what God wanted to do through me. I remember being in my bedroom one night, and it felt like the spiritual condition I was in just took a toll on my body. I felt like I was choking in my bed. And I was like, God, what is this? What is this? I'm just choking. I just don't feel so malnourished. Do you know what saved me? John 15. And we are looking at a lot of scriptures today, and it will be quite a lot to take in. But I feel it's important because for every point I make, I feel God wants to show you what he says in his word. So John 15, it's going to come up on the screens. John 15 verse 4 to 5, and it says, remain in me as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. But apart from me, you can do nothing. And this is what saved me. Other translations of the Greek would say, abide, abide in me and I in you. And I realized during that season of malnourishment that my primary call wasn't to go to a Bible study and to lead that, wasn't to go and go on a coffee with someone and to inspire them with scripture. My primary call was to abide. All those things are necessary and all those things are good and we'll do them, but my primary purpose in life is to know God and to fellowship with him on an intimate level. And that scripture saved me, man. From that day, I was in my room. I was safeguarding my time, saying, no, nothing's going to get in my way of reading this, of being nourished on this word. I want to be a branch that's connected to the tree. I want to experience the nutrients running through my veins, running through my spirit. And that just transformed my life. And so, the third point is to acknowledge that scripture is for our nourishment. So we've seen today that the word is special, and to see that we have to know that the word is our window, our anchor, and our nourishment. And I just want to close by talking about the tension. So there is a tension in all of this, and that tension is, if reading the word of God is so good, then why don't I do it? I mean, that's really evident. That has been a conundrum that's been around for centuries. If reading the word of God is so good, why don't I do it? And it's such a conundrum that Paul in the Bible, he was talking mainly about sin, but he says this in Romans 7, verse 15. It's going to appear on the screen. It says, I do not understand what I do. For what I want to do, I do not do. But what I hate to do, I do. Don't you love how the Bible is so real? I love Paul. He's such a good guy. He's like, I don't understand what I do because I want to read the Bible, but I find myself on Netflix. I want to get intimate with God, but it's just all these distractions that I give myself to. And that's so fascinating. What I want to leave with us today is that we can do practical things. We can do things like Bible in 1 year. Many of us in the church have downloaded our Bible in 1 year apps. There's an app that's available on your phones and also physical copies where an organization called Alpha has prepared scriptures to read every day, probably about 3 or 4, that will take you through the whole Bible in 1 year, which is awesome. And many of us are doing it in the church, and you're getting the nourishment that you need, which is great. But you know, one of the main things we can do is to pray. I was talking to Luke Seymour, who leads our Plymouth congregation, and we were catching up and sharing about life, and I was saying, man, I'm just struggling to balance things. Sometimes it's like I have relationships with people that I want to maintain, but I want to work, but, you know, I want to go and meet up with this person. I want to do this. I'm just struggling. And you know what he said to me? He said, What he said to me was, what you value, you will do. What you value, you will do. And it sounds very small, but it's actually very profound. And he was trying to encourage me that if my value is placed on connecting with people and seeing them grow and seeing them thrive, then I will prioritize that in my diary. But if I don't value it, I'll let it slip. And that was really profound. And I guess I'm not trying to say in here today that no one values the Bible. I'm not trying to say that. But what I'm trying to say is that do we value it enough? So that just as in Psalm 1, verse 2, where it says, I delight in the law of the Lord. I delight. The word is my delight. Do we value it enough so it's our delight? And yeah, the way to get there is through prayer, I believe. Because God's spirit lives inside you. If you're a believer in Jesus today, he's put his spirit inside you. The Bible says the spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. The Bible says when Paul was writing to the church, he was saying, I pray that I would decrease so that God would increase in me. God's spirit is living inside you. And so one of the greatest prayers we can pray is, God, I'm not there yet, but would you fan into flames this desire that I want to have? I was catching up with a friend earlier this week, and we were just sharing life, catching up. And he was like, bro, I get it now. I get it. We were in these Bible studies, and all of you and people would be talking about the Bible so passionately, and I just didn't really understand why you would be so passionate about this word, but I get it now. Like, I want to read this book. Everything I need is in this book. And it's fascinating because he didn't do that. God did. Yeah. I believe that God answered a prayer in his life that, God, I'm not where I want to be. If I'm honest, I don't love your word like I want to. I get to Leviticus and I'm thinking, what is this? But I believe God honors that authentic spirit that says, God, I am where I am. Would you help me? Would you fan into flames the desire that I want to have? I want to touch on one last tension before we go on and pray for this desire to read the word of God. And that tension is worship music. And hear my heart on this. In no way am I trying to downplay worship music. I love it. I think it's beautiful. We were singing praise songs today and it took us into the presence of God. Here as in heaven, what a powerful song. But there were times in my life when I would get home from campus, or even I'd be on campus, and I would find a good slot to read the Bible. I'd have my pocket Bible in my rucksack, and I'm thinking, yeah, I should get this out right now and dip into it. But then there'll be this voice inside of me saying, oh, you can just listen to worship music. I mean, it's got scriptures in it, kind of. It talks about God and Jesus. And I realized that worship music is great, but it's not the inspired word of God. Nothing can substitute the Bible. And just so you hear my heart on this, because in no way am I trying to put worship music down, I've got an analogy. So imagine an Olympic weightlifter who's training for the Olympics coming up. And he's an athlete. He wants to get strong. He wants to get fit as soon as possible so he can make it. And he's just at the dinner table, and he's thinking, you know what? I've tasted water. Water is refreshing. So I'm just going to drink water, and my diet will only be water because that's quick and it's easy and it's refreshing. So let me just drink water and skip out the food. And how many of us, of course, know that that would be missing the point? He needs both the water and the food to meet his goal of building his strength. And I just want to encourage us today. We need both the word and our worship to build up our strength. We need the food of the word of God to be in our bellies. So I'm going to invite Ife to come and join me on stage so she can play guitar softly in the background. And I want to go into a time of prayer and just connecting with God. Before I do that, so that everyone can be included in that, I want to expand more about this grace of God that Daisy mentioned about. And if people want to accept this today, you will have an opportunity to. This is an exciting moment we're going to enter into, church. And so if you're here today and you don't know who Jesus is. You've heard us speak about his remarkable grace. Let me explain it to you. There is a maker of this universe who is both inside of time and outside of time, who is so marvelous. And like I said earlier, one of the greatest questions we could ask is that the complexities of this world, scientists have been pontificating over this for centuries. One of the greatest answers, questions we could ask ourselves is that if the maker of this is really real, who is he? Who is he? And like I say, I put my faith and trust in this word, and the whole congregation of us has put our faith and trust in this word, that he has revealed himself to us, and he says that he is good, and that he loves us, and he wants to do this thing called life alongside us. And he wants us to have that knowledge of him free of charge. And so there is nothing you can do to earn what we call the salvation of God. There's nothing you could do to cross that line and be right with God. He's given it to you for free. As we said earlier, scriptures say that we mess up, we get things wrong. And imagine God is so white and he's so holy. When we get stuff wrong, we start with a white garment, but it became spotted. And nothing else can take away those spots except for the blood Jesus Christ shed when he died for you and me on the cross. And this is called the good news. The good news is that Jesus died and he rose again, and his spirit lives inside each and every one of us, and we can receive him. And the good news is that if you are here today and you are searching for that peace in life, that peace comes first when you have peace with God. And that peace is freely afforded to you through the cross. And so why don't we just maintain an atmosphere of just worship and prayer. And I'm just going to pray this prayer. And I'm going to invite you all to pray it in your hearts. And it goes like this. Jesus, I thank you. Thank you that you're good. Thank you that your love for me is more than I could ever imagine. God, I want to walk this journey of unpacking the scandalous love that drove you to die for me, God. God, you knew me before I was born. You knew me before I was in my mother's womb. And you chose me, God. And so, God, I want to say that I turn right now. I turn from my life of independence, my life away from you, my life of getting stuff wrong and making mistakes. I just turn from that, God. And I look to you. And I see your arms stretched out wide, saying, come. Come and know me. Come and fellowship with me. And God, I receive your new life today. Amen. Amen. This is exciting. And what we do as a church is that if you're here and you want to know Jesus and you pray that prayer in your heart, we're all going to give you a round of applause. And if you raise your hand, our stewards have a really good pack that will help you start this journey in the right way, rooted and firm in Jesus. And so I just want to encourage you, if you pray that prayer, could you just lift up your hand and let me know that you prayed that. Thank you, sir. I see that. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you on the balcony. Thank you. Fantastic. Well, church, this is exciting. Why don't we give a round of applause for God? Listen, if you made that step of saying, God, I want to know you more today, I want to let you know that this is the most enriching experience that you have done. And what happens is that when you walk out of the doors from church later, doesn't mean that everything gets fixed, doesn't mean that all of a sudden that, you know, all the problems in your life just go away, but it means that you have a God who's with you in that, and he wants to walk with you, and he wants to show you what it means to live life to the full. And so that's exciting. So please do open your packs as well. There's a little table at the back of the hall here, and hopefully it'll be manned by someone who's willing to discuss with you more about what it means to follow Jesus. But please do see that. It's just at the back of the auditorium down here. Fantastic. Well, just before we end, I felt that there's a little bit more that God has for us. And I want to invite Steve to come and share what he feels that God is saying to us as a church.
Fantasize it and we laugh about it and joke about it, but it's actually very physically real. Scientists have studied this neurologically, and they can look at your brain patterns and actually see when you're in love, you physically get these endorphins and other things go around your body and you feel high as a kite. And it's the way God designed us. And often I've noticed when people become Christians, they're just in love, and it's amazing to watch, but it's the way God's designed us. And often in that time, I've seen that when people read the Bible, they just get so much from it. And it makes me totally jealous. And it, you know, for some of you mature Christians, it probably makes you jealous as well. You're like, I wish I could flick the Bible anywhere, any page, and God just talks to me. You know, in the Bible, it says there's two ways God talks. It's called the Logos, which is Greek, I think, for the Word of God, the written Word of God. And then there's what they call the Rhema, which is like God's word at this moment, in this time, speaking to you for a situation. And often that Rhema word, it kind of gives us a buzz. It's like, oh, this is amazing. We feel in love. We feel inspired. It helps us very physically in situations we're in. But often, as we get older, we go through seasons of not feeling in love. When you're married, you would have been in love. Unless you were come from a culture where you were put together by your families and you didn't even know each other necessarily, you probably didn't feel in love. But probably in that marriage, over the years, they learned to love each other on a very deep level, beyond us Westerners that are so caught up in the feelings of being in love. And what I want to say to you, I want to inspire you that in your relationship with God, in your relationship with the Word of God, you don't have to worry whether you feel in love or not. Sometimes it will feel totally dry. Sometimes it will feel, I had a leader once that said to me, Steve, when you eat breakfast in the morning, it's probably pretty boring. You probably had the same breakfast thousands of times, but it's nutritious. And it's like that with the Word of God. It can be really boring sometimes. It can feel like it's muesli with not much milk. But the reality is, it does something in your spirit. It gives you nutrition. And I've met lots of mature Christians over the years that I will see them running around to each other and saying, have you got a word of God for me? Could you hear God for me? And it's kind of good that we're there to encourage each other in our times of dryness. We need to look around to those around us when we're feeling dry. It's normal. It's totally okay. But you have to grow up to a point where you say, do you know what? It doesn't matter how I feel. It doesn't matter if I feel in love today or not. It doesn't matter if I read the Bible and I feel like it's feeding me or I don't feel like it's feeding me. The reality is it will feed you. And just one other quick thing. You know, some of you in here will be dyslexic. Some of you will not find reading easy. Sometimes I can read, like I can just read. Other times I could read two sentences and I've forgotten it like that. I can't do it. It just doesn't stay in my head. And for some of you, that's very, very normal. But you know, with modern apps and things, it's so much easier. You know, you can get a thing called Word for the Day on an app and it just gives you one verse. You know, just that one verse a day is enough to give you something. It may not be a whole chapter, but it's something. And as you plant that seed inside you, you will find at some point in the day or in the week or in that month, that word will come back to you. And you will suddenly find that thing you've been reading, that nutritionist, that muesli you've been eating, which is boring, suddenly it becomes alive to you. So I just want to pray for you and I want to encourage you that the Word of God is alive and active. It just doesn't always feel like it, but it is. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would give us the tenacity of an athlete, the discipline of a soldier, that we would read your Word no matter what. When we struggle, Lord, I pray you'd give us the courage to look around to our friends and ask for help. But Lord, I pray you'd give us tenacity in reading your word, that we wouldn't be just looking for the feelings that give us shallow root, but we'd be looking for the long term, for those deep roots that grow in hidden places, those deep roots that grow just from consistent eating and nutrition. Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus that this church would grow to be rooted and grounded in your word. Amen.
I feel like we're going to go into a time of worship and then close afterwards. So Ife, could you lead us in some worship? And just allow God to cement what he's doing in your hearts. He would have been speaking to many of you in the room, and just enter a time of prayer and talking to God and say, God, I want to leave here today with something cemented in my heart. And maybe you're good with reading the word, which is brilliant. Why don't you pray for our campus, that students there, if they're feeling hungry, if they're feeling thirsty, they wouldn't turn to anything the world can offer to feed them, but they would turn to Jesus, who says, if you feed on me, you'll never go hungry, never go thirsty. Great. In this room, God, thank you that you've caused many of us to fall in love with you, Jesus. We pray that we can take that love into our workplaces tomorrow. We pray we can take that love out of the four walls of this building and into a city for it to be transformed in the name of Jesus. Lord, thank you for our students. Oh God, you've deposited such passion in them, God. We pray that they really are game changers for your name. Would you use them to take your love and your gospel out into this world and transform it? There are people who are dying because they don't know you, people who are malnourished, people who know that they need a peace and a joy and a hope, but they haven't had it. Would you make us to be transporters of your gospel and your good news to a broken world? And we see it healed. And Jesus, we long for you. We just declare that we long for you. We know that you are coming back. And you are the risen and resurrected King. We rejoice in your name. Amen. Amen. Well, why don't we give a hand clap for the students and for Jesus. Amen. So, welcome to Rediscover Church. If it's your first time, love to see you again next week, Sunday. What we love to do at the end of the service is stick around for refreshments, get involved in the community. And so there is some drinks. There are some drinks that will come around on the trolley to the front of the hall here. And there'll also be some student teleporters who will transport it around to people who can't get to the front. So do stick around and get to know people. Thank you very much.
Hello and welcome back. We're here in the studio with the lovely Lottie, and we're just going to be having a chat.
Yeah.
So Lottie, tell us a bit about yourself.
So my name is Lottie. I'm a second year history student at the university. I'm from near Brighton in Sussex originally, and yeah, love Jesus.
Amazing. Yeah. So you've obviously just been part of the student service. How did you find kind of all the preparation leading up to that? Was it kind of, was there challenges? Was it fun?
Yeah.
Everything run smoothly?
Yeah, I think in true student style, we left it quite to the last minute, like planning. But it's been a really good time. And like, it was Femi and Anna and Zoe and I and Ellie, who is leading worship today, have been prepping for this for quite a while. And it's been super exciting to be a part of it.
Definitely, yeah, we got that.
Yeah.
So, such a good buzz. Like, the atmosphere out there is genuinely so good.
Yeah.
So much energy.
Yeah. It was so much fun, and like, I loved being a part of it. And just, I think often in our church, students can get quite lost just because some of us look like youth and some of us look like adults. And so, it's quite nice for the congregation to see that we're students and that's what we do. And yeah, it was so good. It was so good.
Did you have a favourite bit of the service? Or was it just all equal?
I mean, I loved hearing from Daisy, her testimony, just because that was, like, I watched quite a lot of that happen, her coming to church and her coming to know God. And so it was really exciting just to see her up on stage. Like, the transformation is amazing, and the stuff that God's doing in her life is awesome. So cool. It was so cool to see her on stage just talking about the grace of God and how amazing that is.
Amazing. Yeah. We have amazing students.
Yes, we do.
So cool. Yeah. So it's the end of the service. Mm-hmm. Are you a little bit knackered after all?
So I've been ill this weekend, and so I came in this morning like, but Femi prayed for me, and literally Jesus happened. Oh, so amazing. I like got up and I was like, I'm fine. This is fine. But I have a feeling I'm going to crash afterwards. So just sleep. For
you deserve
hours
it.
And hours,
just have a good rest.
Yeah, it's all good.
God is good. God is so good.
Yeah. Come on. I just wanted to ask, so what's the coolest thing that's happened to you in terms of Jesus since you've been here?
In terms of Jesus?
Oh, yeah.
Wow.
Oh,
yeah. Since I've been here, crikey, that's a really big question.
And how long have you been here first?
So I came to Rediscover in my first few weeks of university last year. So I've been here about a year and a half now. It's amazing. It's pretty much the exact opposite of my church back home, in the way that we do things and the size of it. So, and like, I love my church back home, like, they love Jesus, but I come here and you guys also love Jesus, and it's just amazing to be part of this community. My biggest Jesus moment, I guess the prayer room downstairs has been a massive thing for me. Just learning how to be with God by myself. I think that's a big thing. When you come to uni, you get here and all of a sudden you're completely on your own. You haven't got your family to make you go to church. You've got yourself in a room, in halls, and it's really scary. So I guess just learning how to be in relationship with God by myself was a massive thing that I've learned. And the prayer room downstairs was also like great in that I can just book a session and just go into that room where there's such good resources, and I could just be with God and just spend time in his presence.
Amazing. So cool. I've heard a lot of amazing testimonies actually coming out of the prayer room, and if you're in Exeter or local to Exeter, we have a prayer room downstairs. It's open 24/7, so make use of that resource if you can, because it's really cool. Thank you so much for chatting to us. That was amazing.
Thanks, Lottie.
Cool. So if you want to go and have a rest. Yeah. You deserve it.
Go grab a coffee and a biscuit.
Yeah. All right, bye. So we have another guest.
We do.
For our post-show interview.
Here he is.
Hello. Take Hello. A seat. Take a stool.
Thanks. Thank you.
Tristan.
I've made a return. I'm back. Hi.
Yes. So, Tristan.
Hello.
Who are you? Tell us a bit about yourself.
Thanks, Scott.
Keep it broad. Okay, let's be more specific. What are you studying? Are you a student?
I am a student indeed. I'm studying medical sciences. Yes, it's as dull as it sounds. I study that. I come from Derbyshire, so if anyone knows where that is, it's Chatsworth.
Or is there currently watching, perhaps?
Yes, possibly. My mum, you never know. So yeah, that's about as exciting as I am. That's about all I can tell you about my life.
What part did you just play in the service?
I was in the worship team, which is my first time doing that. It was my debut. But it was I really enjoyed it, actually. I had a really great time.
It was great, yeah.
Yeah, normally I kind of just like go along through worship, like, yeah, this is all right, it's okay. But it was really good, I really enjoyed it. Yeah.
Nice. You played the game, not the occasion.
Yeah, you
That's
know
really
it. Yeah, oh, nice.
Fun. Do you have a favourite worship song that you enjoy singing?
Oh, nice. Here we go. Cornerstone, that is one of my favourites.
It's a classic. Big tune, that, isn't it?
Classic, yeah. We've always got to go back to Cornerstone, but yeah, it's up there.
Good. And did you enjoy the service in general?
It'd be bad if I said no,
yeah,
wouldn't
it?
Yes. Of course I did. I really enjoyed it. I thought the interviews was really nice. It's quite nice to have a different touch on it and hear from different people, so I really appreciated that. And also just Femi's talk, nice picture of a tree as well in the background. It was all essential. I liked it.
Great. So you're a student, are you part of any societies on campus? What do you do in your spare time?
Yeah, what I do in my spare time, I do some sort of sports. I've had to retire from playing rugby, but
how old are you?
I'm 21, so
21.
early retirement.
It's the old head getting knocked out too many times. Dangerous sport, but good fun. And I also do a bit of musical theatre. Rogue, yes.
You're like the Troy Bolton of Exeter.
Oh, that's the dream.
A man of many talents.
One day I'll be Troy Bolton.
Do you also hit the gym?
Yeah, occasionally.
Yeah. What's your favourite machine?
I'm not too. I don't really like machines, mate.
Mine's the vending.
Yeah, nice.
There we go.
Yeah, there we
if
go.
You go to the gym at Exeter,
do you say hello.
Say hello to Tristan.
Yeah, cool. That'd be cool. Nice. I'd say hello to you back. That'd be really good.
Great. Glad to hear that.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, thank you so much for saying hello. Unless there's anything else that you want to ask.
So how do you find being a Christian on campus?
I find it okay. It's sometimes quite hard, especially when the lot of people that you know seem to be part of the rugby club, which is not the most accepting of faith. So I find that's quite it's quite difficult, quite challenging, but good experience. And it's nice, there's so many other Christians we know on campus, like go to this church, ECU, that sort of thing. So it's always good to have connections with them. But so yeah.
That's great. Nice. Thank you very much for joining.
Yeah, thank you.
For joining us.
I will depart.
Yes. Go and have a biscuit. Have a rest.
Right, see you in a bit.
See ya.
Cool. So we have another special guest.
Yes, we do.
If you'd like to join us. So this is the amazing Femi who leads, yes, that's your official title. That's on your birth certificate. He leads us students, and he's cool. So hello, Femi.
Oh, hey, Ella and Elliot. How are
hello,
you?
Femi.
Hi, everyone online. How are we? We good?
Yes, we're having a good morning. It's been really
it's
fun.
Oh, it's been great.
Loving the service.
Okay.
So I just wanted to chat to you a bit. Obviously, you oversee students, so you've obviously had quite a big role in putting this all together. How's that process been? And hit any challenges?
Okay, in student fashion, it's been a bit last minute. Joking, not really.
Not really.
Have there been any challenges? I think it's all been really smooth. I think it's been a good process of seeing students just grow and thrive, and seeing, like, for example, Lottie take on that prayer ministry. She could have easily been intimidated one of the first times she's talking to the whole congregation, but she handled it so well. And I love that she also was listening out for what she felt God was saying to her. And so that wasn't scripted, but she totally felt that in the first service she shared about the scripture from Joshua. And in this service just shared, she shared about the picture of the cross. And it seemed to really touch people. So it's good to see students being so in step with what God is doing. Yeah.
Oh, amazing. So if you could just maybe tell us a little bit about student ministry in general. So when we meet and what your role is kind of day to day.
Great. So my role at Rediscover Church is operations and student pastor. So I look after church logistics, organizing projects, and also the student ministry, which is great, probably the most energizing part of my job. It's been a good journey of seeing students want to meet more regularly with each other. So at the start of the academic year, we only had worship nights maybe once a month, but students have asked, actually, can we do this fortnightly on a Monday? Mm-hmm. And so we do. And there's not really any set script or any set way it happens, but you know, the one consistent thing we try to do is have students share their story of how they came to know Jesus, because that always encourages other people. But it's been really great just to see students like you, for example, Ella, just get stuck in. And Ella's bubbling with different ideas. So we're coming for you, Church Online and people. But it's been wonderful.
That's great. Yeah.
Another thing that I've loved as well is just seeing student-aged people come along to the student nights. So on a Monday when we meet, we don't just have university students, but we'll have 18 and over people. So people who go to college or people who are just doing life in the city. Elliot, for example, came along. You're 19.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Strapping young man. and single, yeah.
Wow. Thank you, guys.
Yeah. Just so you
indeed.
Know.
We could have his number going for someone on the screen, that'd be great. But.
But it's been great to see Elliot come along. And I know you can't make any more because you have your work now. Yeah, but when you were here, you were such a vibrant part of student night. So thank you.
I loved it. Yeah.
Cool. So Femi, you were at the university last year.
Yeah.
What was kind of, why have you stuck around? I'm glad you have. But kind of like, why? What kind of, what was that process of deciding to stay in Exeter a bit longer?
Great. So I did a law degree at Exeter University, and that was great. Really enjoyed it. What I felt God challenged me about is that my deepest motives for doing the law degree was so I could be a lawyer in future, which isn't bad, but my motivation was mainly to earn lots of money. And God was just telling me that actually life is too short to live it just for money. There's a deeper purpose that he wanted me to explore. And so it was interesting, really fascinating to walk that. And at times I felt like I was almost on a tightrope, but God just really taught me about trust. And he said that, look, if you just listen and trust that I'm speaking to you here and not going to law, something that is God-filled and God-purpose will turn up. And lo and behold, I graduate and I'm now working at Rediscover Church, which I can totally see God's hand over. I don't think this is every person's call. You know, we're not all called to work in a church. God wants people to be lawyers because he wants to represent his kingdom in that sphere. But just for my specific life, after graduating, God wants me to be here. And it wasn't easy taking that step of trust. But you know what? Once I took the step off what felt like a cliff, it was just done. And actually, very soon after taking that step, I felt like there was a platform just right there to catch me. And actually, it wasn't a jump off a cliff. It was just a step of faith and trust. Yeah.
Amazing. So, thank you so much for sharing that. That's so interesting. Yeah. I think, you know, if you're a student and you're kind of thinking about your next steps, I'm sure you'll be very encouraged by that. So cool.
I mean, if you're a student, I'd just love to encourage you that there's something in you, and all the passions that you feel, they're not there by mistake. Also, all the burdens you feel, like some people walk down Exeter High Street and you just see like the homelessness that's here and they get so burdened. That's not by mistake. God is trying to communicate something to you there and saying, actually, there's a deeper purpose and desire I put in you for a reason. So explore that. Have fun and explore that. You've got nothing to lose, really.
Thank you. That's great. I know we're very encouraged, and hopefully everyone at home is as well.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for sharing with us.
You guys are awesome. They're awesome. Great.
So go and have a rest. You deserve it.
Love you, Femi.
Thank you.
Bye. See you, bro.
Cool. Oh, that was amazing.
That was good fun, wasn't it?
We really love encouraging stuff. Yeah, so thank you so much for sticking around to listen to that. Hopefully you were encouraged. Let us know on the chat online. We'd love to hear and connect with you.
Yes.
Yeah.
And through other forms of social media as well.
Yeah, so
Instagram, Facebook.
So just search for Rediscover Church And we'd love to connect with you and get to know who you are, what makes you tick, where you're from, and what your walk with Jesus is looking like.
Yeah, fantastic.
Cool.
Great.
One other thing that's popped up today is, obviously, we spoke a bit about NUMA,
yes.
which is something that is amazing. It's going on campus. They meet on Wednesday nights. If you're interested in that, or that's something that you kind of felt stirred when they were talking about that earlier, if you want to speak to our pastor about that, they can give you some more information.
Yes.
Or check out NUMA on social media.
Yeah, on their Facebook page. Just type in NUMA, have a look.
Yeah, they are cool. Amazing. So thank you so much
for tuning
in.
Have a great week, guys.
See you next Sunday.
God bless.